Nee. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Father, in your hands we place this evening as we learn your word. Enlighten our hearts, minds, our attitudes, so that we may produce fruits which will bring glory to your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. That's good.
Yeah.
Good.
I'm back
So,
after about a month, I think. Yeah.
yes,
Yes.
you're back in Bangalore, so
Yes.
that's good. Good. So I was speaking about this hierarchy of petitions. Yesterday we saw that from Catechism of the Catholic Church, that we saw that we can pray for everything,
Yeah.
anything and everything. However, there is a hierarchy of petitions. What should come first? What should be given priority over what other intentions and so on? We saw that. And I gave you the example of a couple of people yesterday. So now we continue. I'll today conclude with the praying for occasions and going to the other petition that Jesus said, which we can conclude tomorrow. Then we'll go into another important topic, our Father. In Catechism of the Catholic Church, there is a long section on our Father. It's very beautiful. The seven petitions of our Father. Okay, so. And then, they've got almost one, two, three, four pages of that. No, more. So you can find a lot of points. Anyway, they all will be summarized and given. That'll be next time when we meet. Okay, today, so I'll conclude with this shepherd. I gave yesterday 3 points. What can be done? First one, I said prayer is a strategy. Number one, to pray and pray earnestly. Second, I said, we being open, if God wants us to be part of that whole plan, being open to it. And third point, I said, how trying to help people from Samuel, when Samuel had a vocation, he was called by God, but 3 times God called, but he did not realize it until the prophet there, until that priest really helped him, Eli helped him. So I saw, so probably God, and I gave you example of Christopher D'Souza, under whose name I appear here. And he was one of the examples. I said how people are giving him a little bit of, and then, and of course he saw our community and he was a lawyer, making good life, and then he left everything and joined us and became a Somaskan. So I said, oh, and that is not the only case. There are many who, because someone suggested to them, maybe you could become a priest. You look like a priest, or probably you pray very well. So why don't you try to, discern your vocation? Some people have given them a little nudge, little push, little, encouragement, and that has led them to become priests. So that also has to be done. Now, what is the role there? God calls them. See, we cannot produce vocations. We cannot call. God calls them. We only support them to discover that call, to discern, And finally, I will conclude today that intention with this, this God's call, it is, of course, we are speaking about call to priests and religious. So we saw from Matthew chapter 9, we saw that Jesus telling this to apostles. But the same passage, when it come to Luke, it'll come to the 72 disciples. Okay, that's Luke chapter 10. So you'll be sending 70, actually 72 disciples, but in the Bible you'll find 70. 72 also it can be, because 12 tribes, each tribe had an equal number, or 70 because Moses had 70 elders to help him. So however you take it, no? So this is, some Bibles you'll find 72, some Bibles you'll find 70 elders, no? That's Luke chapter 10. And now the 70, it's a wider call. to mission, missionary work. Now, this is very, very important. Who can be missionary? Who should be missionary, Jose, in your understanding?
One who has got a desire to share the gospel and deep desire to share the gospel.
Okay. Suppose a person who has no desire, can he be?
He cannot be.
Yes. Now, while you are very right in understanding of the missionaries who go out and proclaim the gospel, but not, church says one thing. Church says one thing.
Not the going out, Father.
Yes.
Even I am a missionary. I am not going out. No, you are a missionary.
Exactly. So missionary is one who is baptized, one who has known Christ. Anyone, the church is very clear. Church is by nature missionary, which means anyone who is baptized should be a missionary. That means everyone, anyone who has tasted Christ should give Christ to others. So missionary task of proclaiming, preaching the gospel is task to everyone. So now just get this, don't get confused. I was speaking until now about priesthood. That is one dimension of the missionary work, the sacramental dimension, and also preaching the gospel authoritatively and giving the sacraments, you know, as it is all those ministries that are spoken of in Ezekiel chapter 34, you know, there it is speaking about all the priestly ministry, you know, shepherding. But now, taking from Luke, the same thing, Jesus sends out 70 people. I come to a wider range. Missionary activity, proclaiming Christ. Everyone should do it. All baptized should do it. All baptized should do it. Now, do you think that all should do it, Jos, or you think that it is simply as symbolic or figurative?
It is not symbolic. It is Pope John Paul II's
Evangelii Nuntiandi, and so on. Yes.
Everyone, every baptized Catholic is supposed to be sharing the gospel.
Exactly. You are very right, Joseph.
Right, yeah.
All of us have to be missionaries. So I also hearing, please know that no one is freed from the task of proclaiming the gospel. No one. Whether you are elderly, whether you are young, whether you are sick, whether you are healthy, whether you are knowledgeable, you are not, all of us. But the method and mode of doing it is different. Now, this is very important. When does the missionary spirit come? When do you think the missionary spirit will come?
Missionary spirit comes once you have a clear understanding of God's love in your own life.
That is exactly when you're tasted. You are very right. When you're tasted something simple, I know these people. Some people who have gone for a holiday to a particular place. When they come back, what do they say? Oh, that place is fantastic. You should go there. You should see it. You know, even normal movies. People who have seen some movies, they will come and say, "Oh my God, that movie is really fantastic." You know, when there was one secular movie, Bahubali came. These people told me, "Oh, this movie is so nice, so beautiful. Father, you must watch it. You should not miss it, Father." It's, you know, you know, I didn't ask them to tell me. And they were not getting any commission from Bahubali producer.
Yeah.
They saw, they enjoyed, and it came from within, unasked for. You see, that is the thing. If you have tasted Christ, you will become automatically a missionary. You can't help it.
Yeah.
That is what we find in the Samaritan woman. When she just knew that Jesus is the true God and the only way to worship God is through the method that Jesus says, she goes and brings many more people.
Yeah.
She couldn't contain it. She couldn't keep it to herself.
Yeah.
So the question for us always is, have you tasted God?
Yeah.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Have you tasted? So, tasting his goodness will make us missionaries. That is the first thing. Second, how you can be missionaries. This is where we should not mistake that all of us will not be called to go out and preach into the streets. Not even in any way. All of us. But all of us will be called to be called missionaries. Now, Jos, do you know who is the patroness of missionaries?
Patroness of missionaries?
Yes, Teresa of Child Jesus. Yes. Do you know she is considered patroness of missionaries?
Yes, never gone.
She never went out of her convent. And she died at the age of 24.
Yeah.
She never stepped out of her convent.
Mm.
How come a woman who never went out of the convent is made a missionary? Yeah. Patroness of missionaries. That is where comes how she lived her life. So being a missionary is not simply, becoming a missionary is not simply activity, but very being. That's where church, the document will say, church is mission.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I am mission. Not I am a missionary. I am a mission. I am. So our very being. So she had that desire. You know, probably you might have heard of that, that she was praying for the conversion of one convict, one who was imprisoned and sentenced to die. You heard of that, Jos?
No, no, I have not.
See, there was, what, how it happened was, she was praying for a man about whom she came to know through, you know, newspapers, whatever it is, that this man was a hardcore criminal. And he was convicted and he was supposed to be hanged. And she was praying for his conversion, saying that before his death that he should reconcile with God. And the priest used to go to meet him, but he would always refuse. He would say, no, I don't need confession. He would always refuse. He would chase off the priest. And she kept on praying. And even a day before, he refused to welcome priest. And she was really, you know, sort of discouraged. My God, why? Then next day she came to know that just as he was being led to the gallows to be hanged, and as everything they were preparing and the priest was there standing, just before being hanged, he grabbed the cross from the priest's hand and kissed it. That touched her. When she came to know that, she said, look, last minute it has worked. So that gave her real motivation. So she decided, I'm not going to see now the fruit. I'm not going to wait for the result. So she offered her life for the conversion of sinners, that all may know Jesus Christ, that all souls may be saved. And that is how comes her little ways. Every simple thing she will do for missionaries. She will say, for instance, when someone is praying in the chapel, there was one nun in a convent. The mannerisms really annoyed her. Even prayer, when she goes into the church, the way the other nun was praying, you know, silent prayer and so on, in between she'll making noise, can, and things like that and so on, it used to annoy her. Then at a few times she said, my God, she's loved by Jesus, she's daughter of Jesus, so I love her. And whenever there was some ill treatment for her, from there's of charges from the others, she would put up with it gently, and she would say, I offer it up for the salvation of souls. I offer it up for the missionaries. And so many souls were saved, but she did not know. That is why the church said she gave her entire life, not she went out into the field. Same thing, Jesus, when he appeared to one missionary, I forgot the name of the missionary. Also to St. Faustina, you know, and then but this missionary particularly, I forgot. He told her that the nun who is sick, invalid, paralyzed, lying on the bed, is saving as many souls as the person who is preaching in the field.
Correct.
Offering her life as a libation, as a offering, as a you know, sacrifice for missionaries. This man is offered. So through her, many saving souls are saved.
Yeah.
So God doesn't need activities only from us. God needs us human beings, not our work. Not that God is in need of our work. God needs us, our yes. So this is important. So all of us can become missionaries in our own way. Now, one simple thing. I think I'm sure all of us have Facebook account.
Yeah.
And in the Facebook, you will find people posting about politics. A friend of mine, he belongs to a particular party. Every day you'll find that person posting at least two posts exalting his party leaders, exalting his the man in office who belongs to his party. He's telling about his achievements. Sometimes he reposts the things every day. Now, what is he trying to do? He's trying to influence the mind of people, trying to tell about this particular officer or that particular person, in political person in office is very good. He's doing good to the society and so on.
Right.
Now, let me ask you, why not we do that?
Yeah.
Every day, why can't we post? Sorry, Jos.
Yeah, because we are not ourselves convinced about it, Father.
Okay.
Convinced in the sense, it's not about not conviction. See, there is, I always like to consider a person who, for example, a lover. That initial, some people call it infatuation. Some people call it that, whatever you wanted to name it.
Yes.
Initial feelings, right? Initial love that you experience.
Mm-hmm.
Love is what is missing in many of our lives. That something which, that is what I feel. St. Paul says, tells Timothy to fan the fire that... God has put
yes. Yes, first chapter itself, verse 7. Yes, you are right. Yes.
That is not that is not burning. The sharing thing will not happen in our lives. We will think that it is not required.
Exactly.
So that has to be. I remember once Fritz Maskrenes, Fritz Maskrenes.
Yes.
Somebody told me about his about this experience. So he came to Chennai by the train. Apparently, he had the tickets, but he got into the general compartment because he met some group of six people. Sikh in the sense, Sardar. And they were sharing, he was sharing the gospel with them. And that evening, he went back again to the general compartment because they were also going back.
Okay.
He gospel with them.
Okay.
Now, for a man who had a confirmed ticket, probably he would have had an air-conditioned ticket, I do not know. But for use a general compartment and may not even have the seat because he wanted to share the gospel with the... So, this is the fire.
He wanted to share the gospel. Sorry, tell me, I didn't get you.
No. He wanted to share the gospel with these people.
Okay. So,
it would travel by the general compartment.
Oh, he used to travel by general so that he can meet people and talk to them.
No, not this particular group of people whom he met in the morning.
Okay.
When he came to Chennai from Bangalore.
Mm-hmm.
He knew that they were going back by the same train in the evening. So he tried to, get the general compartment instead of a fully reserved compartment.
So
share the gospel with them. This kind of, people, that is where the touch of the Lord has happened,
Yes. That's why St. Paul in the 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14, he'll beautifully say, love of Christ urges me. I think it's 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14. Let's see if it is there. Yes, 14, verse 14. Love of Christ urges us on. The love of Christ urges. Urge means, from within. It's not outside force. The love of Christ urges us on. Because we are convinced that 5:14 only. We're convinced that one has died for all, therefore all have died. So his conviction of the Jesus knowledge that he has died, he urges him, pushes him to proclaim the gospel.
Right.
So that's why we need that touch of the Spirit. We need to pray. That's why when we pray for missionaries, we have to pray first for ourselves to have the touch of the Spirit, that urge from within. Usually urge is something incontrollable, no? We give in to. So it's kind of the word that uses, love of Christ urges us.
Yeah.
And I used to think, as someone said, So when I celebrate, you know, when I recite rosary, I use meditations different times, different ways and so on.
Mm.
The fourth mystery, in the one little meditation is there. I'm not saying it's wrong. Mm. I use that until the last line. It says, no, Jesus, you're carrying the cross, falling off. And it will say, then urged by the executioners who were scourging him.
Mm.
Now, was Jesus going to Calvary because they were scourging him?
No.
No. What made him go to Calvary? Not the scourging of the soldiers. When he falls down, they will whip him, so he will get up because they are whipping. That's the cow and goats, and you know, they will do when the, you know, when the horse and so on. But no, Jesus, not because of that. Jesus went to Calvary urged by love of God, love of humanity.
Mm.
That's why they say it is not three nails. I read this quotation. It's not the three nails that kept him to the cross.
Mm.
You know,
yeah.
It is, you know, it is his love for the Father and love for humanity that kept him on the cross. Didn't allow him to come out.
Yeah.
Not the three nails. He could have, you know, thrown himself out of it.
Yeah.
As if, so that is it. It's not three nails that kept him on the cross. Love of God, love of the Father, love of humanity.
Yeah.
That should, we should ask for that as a gift.
Mm.
That should become a petition for us in our daily life.
Yeah.
Give me love of God, love of others. That's what, when we pray the rosary, the three first three Hail Marys, for each we put an intention. First Hail Mary for faith, second Hail Mary for hope, third Hail Mary for charity. And charity is this, love of God and love of others. Okay, good. Now, I will fairly conclude this, but before concluding, I'll just read this, I'm just checking the time. Yeah. So, and then I'll go into the next topic, which I will finish tomorrow. I'll conclude that with Ezekiel chapter 34. If you can take Ezekiel chapter 34, verse 4. It's once again about shepherding. You see, what is God's mind? Ezekiel 34, 4 onwards. It's actually accusation of God against shepherds. But what is in God's mind, you'll come to know. See, what does God want from shepherds? Can you read that, please?
Yeah, Ezekiel, Father, Ezekiel.
Chapter 34, 4.
Yeah, chapter 34.
Yeah, you're right. It's there on the screen.
Okay. You have not strengthened the weak. You have not healed the sick. You have not bound up the injured. You have not brought back the strayed. You have not sought the lost. But with force and harshness, you have ruled them.
So this is the thing. Actually, as a shepherd, I need to read this. But for all of us to become aware, see God's mind. God wants that the shepherd should strengthen the weak, heal the sick, bound up the injured, bring back the strayed, search out the lost. But when the lost is there with a force and harshness, if you rule, they will run away. So with gentleness of Christ, shepherd, gentle shepherd, you know. So what I mean to say with this, I want to conclude is that now you pray that we will continue to have shepherds who do this, who will be on fire with these desire, with this desire of God that we find from desire of God that we find through Ezekiel, I would say. It's not Ezekiel who says, God says. God wants shepherds to strengthen the weak, to search for the lost, bring back the strayed, pray. And you, in your own way, can be. There's one group, now I'm not saying that group is better or not. You know, Frank Duff. Have you heard of Frank Duff?
Frank Duff, no.
No. He is a founder of Legion of Marys.
Okay.
Now, Legion of Marys is a prayer group, but it's not simply a prayer group. Now it has come.
It's a Catholic, it's a Marys association, no? Marys.
Yes, yes. But it is not a prayer group. It is a group of apostolic prayer group, which means how the method is like this. How did it start? Frank Duff saw that many Catholics were going astray and they were becoming non-Catholics, lured by other churches and so on. So what did he do? He said, we have to find a solution. He was a lay person. And he said, now the priest is not able to reach out to many because there's a shortage of priests. Yesterday, I told all of you to check on Google about the real situation of priests, how many priests are there for how many Catholics and so on. No? When Frank Duff realized it, he thought, we have to help the parish priest. The main aim of the Legion of Marys is to help the parish priest. Their own sanctification, of course, their own sanctification. Then the sanctification of others by helping the parish priest. So what they will do, they will go and visit homes. Even now, it is if you read the handbook, visiting families is mandatory. It's not a prayer group, come together, say rosary, and then over. No, they have to do every week, each legionary. It's a mandatory Legion of Mary rule, is that 2 hours, they should have done substantial apostolic work, like visiting families at the discretion of the parish priest, under the banner of Blessed Virgin Mary, talking to the people, and then bringing the issues of the people to the parish priest, taking parish priest's instruction to them. You know, I had in my parish, they were very good help. One thing they did was do the census of the parish. I got some 25 legionaries staying for 15 days, leaving everything, staying in our parish hall. They'll go in the morning, they'll come back in the evening, visiting families, giving them prayer cards, getting their detailed census. Census means not only how many of them are in the family, but what are their needs? Who is a widow? Who has lapsed? Who needs to be counseled? And all those. And they will give it to me. See, now lay people, what I mean to say, missionary work. Lay people can support the shepherds in this missionary work. Those who can. Those who cannot, at least the prayer and other things. And the other one, last thing, people support missionary work with their resources. Luke chapter 8, verse 1 to 3, if you read. And who helped Jesus with their resources? Some women who were healed of their infirmities. Women, like you'll tell about names like Mary, Magdala, and Joanna, wife of Herod Chusa, and many others. And they provided with their resources from whom evil spirit went out. I'm sure all of you are doing it, but I'm trying to encourage you, helping you understand how we are missionaries in also in this way, supporting with your resources. Resources does not mean only money. It could be your time. It could be your talent. It could be something you can type out and give to people who are missionaries, you know, things like that. Okay? All sorts of resources.
One question I have here, Father.
Yes, yes, yes.
While we are talking about, the resources, see, then one difference that I see between the Catholic, Catholics and the Protestants.
Yes.
Among the Protestants, the missionary zeal, those who very high.
Okay.
In the sense, for that matter, especially when it comes to the resources.
See,
the
organization
that I work, we are absolutely, funded by, such people.
Yeah, okay.
But there's a couple of millions, about, 15, I think around that kind of a, and it's all funded. In the last 50 years, it's been happening. And you don't find such support for the lay people in the Catholic Church, Why is it so, Father?
The one thing is that, that Book of Malachi, there is a famous passage about giving tithe. You might have definitely heard of it, no?
Yes.
Malachi chapter 3, the question will start, will anyone rob God? Will anyone steal from God? That's the question it starts. That's 3:8. Malachi chapter 3 verse 8. Now I've heard people preaching this and telling people become conscious that when they don't give to God what is due from their resources to support the ministry, which is their privilege. See, if I can give, provide money to support missionary work. It is my privilege. It's not that I'm doing some favor.
Mm.
I will get 100-fold.
Mm.
Yesterday we saw 934 of 941 of Mark, no? How even if you give a glass of water to support a Christian, you will not go without reward. So when I give someone 110, I'm not losing, I'm actually gaining. And they preach and they convince the people about it. Make people conscious of this, conscientizing, no? About this Malachi chapter 3, verse 8 onwards, what is there? Which we don't do much in, probably, in the Catholic Church. Even probably,
It's also, Father, I'm just saying, you know, see, you know, generally, the idea, generally, when I'm thinking about, you know, see, the call for the, in among the Catholics, lay people to become more evangelist and missionary.
I'm coming to that one, second point. The second point, I'm coming to that. We, in the Catholic Church, we think preaching, it's a task of priests.
It's
a task of the sisters. Now, I'm coming to that one. Anyway, you, Jayas. The first with the resources. Second thing, the people think, there are three reasons. Your second one, you're touched upon. You carry on. Tell me from your way. It's a task of the priest. Yeah.
There is a probably, you know, all those people who are doing right now, are doing it mostly out of their own, you know, interests and their own, or they work within their own resources.
Yes.
If you really look at the, you know, JCLM or anybody for that matter, or Happy Families, we don't have any fund collection, or, you know, we do it our own money, right?
Okay.
So most of the Catholic ministries are like that. So what is the church's view on that in terms of...
that's what I'm telling you. This idea that all are called to be... Jane had put it at 638, give it will be given, you know? A good measure. Okay. Now, what happens is that we Catholics think that preaching is task of religious fathers. Yeah. And some have more mentality of... we don't generalize. What we see is our religious observance has become confined to fulfilling some obligations.
Mm.
Like, I have to go for Sunday Mass. And the idea of also duck in and duck out.
Mm.
I have done my duty. I've gone to Sunday Mass. It's over.
Mm.
I've done my duty. I've been a good Catholic. So, the existential awareness, that's the third point I would have said. I'll jump that also. The second point is, I said about the our source. The second point, always we think it's task of priest and religious. It's not my task to preach. I cannot preach, I'm not allowed to preach, and so on. So I don't have to. Third one is the experiential knowledge of Christ is missing in some of us, Catholics. We don't experience him in the depth. We don't feel the joy of belonging to him. We don't feel that Christ is someone very personal. Because sometimes certain devotions, I'm in favor of devotions, okay, we never say no to any devotion. Some devotions may make us take refuge in them as a means of securing your earthly life and nothing more than that.
Yeah, that is the thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
In the earthly life.
Yes. And so, I pray to St. Anthony. So I need this. He'll give that. And then we say, St. Anthony has heard. And then we are so happy and we go ahead.
Mm.
We think and we have done something.
Mm.
And people are, you know, that is why education is important. If you, for this actually very beautiful, Scott Hahn, you heard of Scott Hahn?
Yes.
In his book, first book, which is Rome Sweet Home, which is his own conversion journey, there is the epilogue, you know, prologue, not the front, the epilogue will be at the end. He speaks about this very clearly. See, he's telling about himself. He was an evangelical, you know, pastor.
Yeah.
And he was telling, Lutheran pastor he was, and he was telling, we do not have real presence of Christ, but we celebrate Christ. And you have real presence. Jesus is truly, verily present in the sacrament. And his power is very truly present, concretely manifested in confession, in thing and so on. Why don't you celebrate it? And therefore, you don't attract people. You don't become Catholics who really attract others because you don't celebrate. People like celebration, no? That is the problem. How many of us feel that joy when we go for confession, that joy of being forgiven, something, the joy of being cleared of my debts, you know, freed of that. That joy will make us share that with others. No, I go, suppose I have had a debt and I tell the person, sorry, let's say I borrowed from you. I say, sorry, Jose, I cannot pay you back. And then you tell me, Father, no problem, I waive it off. No, you don't have to pay. Suppose it's a big amount, I'll be so happy. I'll tell, oh, you know, Jose was so good. He waived off his debt for me. I don't know whether you'll do it, but just for example, no? And I will tell around that one. We don't experience, how many of us go and proclaim, I have been forgiven today. So those who are interested, read that book, at least epilogue, Rome Sweet Home of Scott. It really challenges Catholics. It really challenges Catholics.
That's an amazing book. That's an amazing book.
Yes, yes, it is. Beautiful. I had it here in my library. Yes, I should have it here. So, yes. It is. Very beautiful book. I was looking at the shelf. They could spot it immediately. So many books are there anyway. But yes, I read it a couple of times. I've given it also to Rome Sweet Home. Yes, yes. His conversion story. Very beautiful. How God led him. And you know that he's a real Catholic today. You know that, no, staunch Catholic.
Yeah.
And his teachings are terrible.
So
somebody has asked to type the name of the book. Already he has typed, Jose has typed, Rome Sweet Home. That is the name of the book.
Yeah.
Rome Sweet Home.
By Scott.
Because he was a Lutheran pastor and he became a Catholic. Now he has got two sons who are priests in his family.
Right.
Okay. So I will move on to next one. I'll tell you why that. So now we have said all these things, very beautiful, but all of this will come to us automatically when we are filled with
the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. Now I've been telling you the reasons, the 1, 2, 3, but when the Holy Spirit comes, you can, that's why St. Paul, no? 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3. No one who is filled with the Holy Spirit cannot say curse upon Jesus.
Right.
That means if you are filled with the Holy Spirit, you cannot but, you know, you cannot but really proclaim Christ.
Yeah.
And the apostles will say, we cannot disobey God.
Yeah.
Speaking, let Jesus be cursed. No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit comes, you will be proclaiming. And when the apostles were beaten up, and they'll tell them, and then they'll beat them up and they'll tell them, I warn them, you should not proclaim. And they will be proclaiming the very next day. We know that in Acts of the Apostles. And what will they say? We cannot disobey God.
Yeah.
You see, they were beaten up.
Yeah.
And still the wounds were fresh, but they wouldn't stop. They said, we cannot.
Yeah.
That means there is something in us, that fire, it consumes us.
Yes.
The fire consumes. Like Jeremiah would say, your word is like a churning in my stomach. No, he has to proclaim. So that happens when we receive the Holy Spirit. And here we come, the next petition. That is basis is 11, 13 of Luke, but it's many places, but I base myself 11, 13, where Jesus, it's about teaching about prayer. Jesus teaches about prayer. Then he says, what to ask?
Yeah.
11:13.
Yeah.
So, if you read 11:12, then said, if you are, if you just go a little further, 11:12, if there anyone among you, if your child asks for a fish, will give instead a snake, will give you a snake instead of fish, or if the child asks for an egg, will give a scorpion. Then you read 11:13 now, please.
If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him?
Ah, so we have to ask. That's a petition.
Yeah.
Ask.
And you shall receive.
Yes. So you have to ask for the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
When the Holy Spirit comes upon us, you would have had that real experience. The experience, that's what yesterday I brought to your attention, to the hierarchy of petitions, no? And let the Holy Spirit also in the higher level, in the hierarchy, kingdom, related to kingdom.
Yeah.
And Jesus would, as he asked, and not only Jesus said we would ask, you know, Jesus will also tell, I will also ask for you on your behalf. That's interesting. Jesus will say, you ask, but he'll say, don't worry, I will also ask. You take John chapter 14, verse 16.
Yeah. John chapter 14, 16. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever.
So I will ask the Father. I will ask the Father.
Hmm.
So you ask, but I will also ask. So this is what we call. We call Jesus as an intercessor.
Right.
Okay. The intercessor, no? Heaven intercessor, perennial intercessor. And his intercession is asking the Father to give us the Holy Spirit.
Hmm.
So he's asking that we be received the Holy Spirit. But one, there is one condition, 14, 15.
If you love me, you will keep my commandments.
And I will ask the Father. So they're connected. Let's put it this way. That means that means, see, the it's connected because of this. When you say and, he's not telling only if you keep my commandments or ask, but it's connected. If you keep my commandment, if you are trying to keep my commandment, I will ask the Father to give you the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
Because Jesus will use the word power for the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
You know that, no? Mm. So you just wanted to ask something?
No, no, no. I heard a very beautiful explanation by Father Daniel, which says, see, the Holy Spirit is given to people primarily to follow the commandment of Jesus.
Exactly, exactly. Very true. I'm coming to that. Very true, very true.
Not a condition. You know, follow the commandment and then you get the Holy Spirit.
Yes, but other way around, you can't follow the commandment if you don't have the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, correct, correct. So
once I was preaching to youngsters in Chennapanna, and Father Xavier Convertile was there. It was con celebration of Mass. He said the Mass and I gave the homily. And then Father Xavier Khan was, I told about this, no, that Jesus says, you will ask the Father, if you keep my commandments. So we have to keep his commandments. We have to try to keep his commandments. And Father told, but only if you receive the Holy Spirit, only you can keep the commandment.
Correct.
I told Father, yes, Father, very true.
Yeah.
See, they are interlinked. So if you try to keep the commandment, you will receive the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Only if you receive the commandment, you'll be able to keep that. Only if you receive the Holy Spirit, you can keep the commandment.
Correct. Yeah, so you cannot keep the commandment without the Holy Spirit. That is where the...
Yes, that is where Jesus would tell the apostles, because you see the apostles. Apostles constantly failed. Constantly failed. And despite seeing Jesus raising Lazarus to life. And take these three people, Peter, John and James. What they have seen, what they have not seen. They have seen Jesus transfigured. They've seen Jesus walking on water.
Yeah.
But some others did not get to see. But these three got to see also even those special things.
Yeah.
Having seen all this, still they ran away, no? When Jesus was captured.
Yeah.
Still the mystery. So mystery of the cross will be embraced only when you are the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And that is why that the answer to this, when we will become missionaries, so let's take it Acts 1:8 and also Luke 24:49. These two are similar. First, let's take Luke 24:49. And afterwards, Acts 1:8. Both are same, similar, but the word I want you to pay attention to the word that Jesus uses. Power. Luke 24:49. Okay, you took first Acts 1:8. 24:49.
And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high.
Yes, the power from on high. The word he uses is power from on high. Power stands for God, you know that, the power and then Father. See, and you are witnesses of these things. See, 24:48, it's on the screen.
Yeah,
it says you are witnesses, witness of all my actions. That means you have to proclaim it, my death and resurrection, everything. But for that, you need a power from on high. And who is that power from on high? Holy Spirit. You should be clothed with it.
Yeah.
Same Luke will in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verse 8. That's also written by Luke, of course, 1:8, Acts of the Apostles.
Acts 1:8.
1:8.
But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses.
Ah, so when you receive the Holy Spirit, you'll be my witnesses.
Yeah.
So to be witnesses, to be missionaries, we should be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Right. Right.
When you are filled with the Holy Spirit, we cannot help but become missionaries.
Yeah.
Even our very activities, daily activities will become, will be filled with mission, mission spirit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, that's very interesting. In the Acts of the Apostles, we know that deacons were chosen to serve the, at the table, you know that,
yeah,
to feed the widows.
Yeah.
But do you see that deacons were only serving, feeding the widows and sitting at home?
No.
No. Stephen, one of the, he went and preached. That's why he was, and Philip, the Holy Spirit shifted him and led him to the Ethiopian eunuch,
yeah,
in Samaria. See, they were chosen and do this one. But after doing that, the time they had, they were preaching. They were not obliged to. They were not bound to.
Mm.
Something that fire within.
Mm.
Fire within. Mm. So you want to be missionaries, you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Then you keep the commandment. The very fact of keeping commandment. And so, now, I will, tomorrow I will speak about different aspects of receiving the Holy Spirit, what it means. I will speak about that with the seven gifts, what it, how you receive a gift of the Holy Spirit or the Holy Spirit himself for different aspects of your life. But today I will continue with this one.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit, you might have heard this before, but I have to ask. Jesus himself will ask.
Mm.
And there is also the invitation.
Yeah.
Joseph, you were speaking about, no? John chapter 7.
Yeah.
Verse 36. You were speaking about one day. You remember your discussion with me? John chapter 7, 37 onwards, the life-giving water.
Yes, yes, correct, yeah, yeah.
So, let anyone who is thirsty come to me.
Yeah.
So, you have to thirst, life-giving water will flow. Because, see, the context is this, as you know in the history, those times in the on the last day of the festival, they will take water from Siloam and they will pour it from top, it will run through the thing. So it's the people knew all those things, water flowing. And water was symbol of God's grace flowing in Ezekiel, the vision.
Right.
The water from the church, through the right, it came out through the east. And wherever the water went, the trees, there were a lot of fruits. The water is for the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the grace of God,
mm-hmm,
which for us is through baptism, you know.
Right.
And then so they had these symbols and the gestures of the symbolic actions, rituals. And so Jesus says, you know, you come out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water. That means when you believe from your heart,
yeah,
living water will flow.
Yeah.
From your heart.
Yeah.
So that is very important.
Right.
And then, yeah, so we have seen people how they are. So there was one, my full name is Stanley. He came to Attapadi. I didn't see personally, but I heard from one priest who went there. And also Father Vinoy was telling about him. He is a lay person. He preaches, goes around. I written down somewhere his name. Because then Vinoy said. And then Father Vinoy, no? And then he, when this lay person was preaching, and then while he's preaching, you know, the people feel the power of the Spirit.
Right.
The healing. And deliverance and so on. Of course, not everyone, but many. And then, so when he was asked, he told, it seems, to Father Vinoy, as I heard, if you are really a Christian, even your shadow should reflect Christ and give Christ to others.
Right.
Otherwise, you belong to religion of Christianity, but not to Christ.
Yeah.
So some of us belong to religion of Christianity, including me probably, but may not be Christians in the sense of belonging to Christ, which,
yeah,
means encouragement for us to deepen, to be rooted in Christ, as St. Paul would say, to be rooted in Christ.
Yeah.
We don't have, we immediately somebody think, what should I do? I will give up this, I will give up that, I will pray in the morning, pray in the evening. No, don't start thinking that way. Taste Jesus. To be rooted in Christ is to taste Jesus, to live with Jesus the whole day. You know?
Yeah.
Doing extraordinary things with, ordinary things with extraordinary love for Jesus. As Colossians 3:17 says, whatever you do in deed or word, if you're cooking, if you were cooking, you tell Jesus, I'm going to cook now for my family. It's my duty. It's you have given this. I'm doing it for you, Jesus.
Yeah.
Do it. Like Teresa of Child Jesus.
Yeah. So that awareness is very important for us. Otherwise, you will not be able to grow in the spirit, because being in the presence of the Lord, that being aware of the presence of Lord in our every time.
Yes, yes, yes.
God actually makes or breaks a person, in our spiritual growth, because we at times think that. You do some spiritual exercise like your prayer time, your Bible reading. Those are important, very important, extremely important. At the same time, another important thing which I feel is that you being aware of the fact that you are always present, you're always in the presence of God, because the body is a temple of God's Holy Spirit. And God's Spirit is dwelling in me. So if that awareness, it is something which God has to give, I guess, or I don't know whether we can.
Yes, God has to give. See, yep. This is where we have to get in the depth of the understanding of incarnation of Christ. Mm. See, we have still in our mind, there is a dichotomy, a mundane, a spiritual things and secular things.
Yes.
And this is a sweeping is secular work, praying is a thing. And we compartmentalize our spiritual life, compartmentalized spiritual life. Okay.
It's a beautiful story. There is a beautiful story. The other day, Jude was sharing in our group, but I have heard about this. That story goes like this. There was this group of, can I tell that, Father?
Yes, please.
So the story is about a young boy who, along with his classmates,
when
their professor took them for a picnic. Places which had religious importance.
Okay.
In United Kingdom, in Europe. Okay.
Mm.
And, they went and they came to a place where John Wesley was living.
Okay.
John Wesley and the professor took them into different rooms where John Wesley lived. His the dining room, the living room, the kitchen, his bedroom. So different rooms, and he was explaining this is where John Wesley spent most of his time.
Mm-hmm.
And then they found a carpet which was laid on John Wesley's room, and one corner of the carpet was torn. Mm-hmm. And so this student, this boy asked, what is this carpet? Why is this portion torn? And the professor said, this is the place where John Wesley spent most of his time on his knees praying to the Lord for the revival of Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And this boy was very impressed. And they all went back to the bus to go to the next location. So the professor counted and found one boy missing. And so he went back to to this building to find where he is, and he went into all rooms and he couldn't find. Finally, he went to the bedroom, and the professor standing on the other side of the bedroom saw this boy kneeling down on the same carpet where this torn marks were there, and this boy was praying, God, can you do it once more? Can you do once more with me? Please, God, can you do once more with me? And he was praying to God, crying out to God with these words from his mouth. Then the professor walked to the boy and put his hand on the shoulder and said, come, son, let us go back. And Billy Graham rose from his knees and joined the rest of the
Okay.
That was Billy Graham's story, So he was crying out to God to use him as a powerful instrument, and how beautifully God heard his cry. I think it also depends upon our, our response.
Exactly.
Today I was listening to Father Daniel, beautifully explains the Phoenician woman's response when Jesus said, this will not be given to the dogs. You know, Jesus intentionally called dog, but then she did not respond by, she was not offended. She was not, she did not go back, but she stayed there. So our internal response, attitude to God's, God's calling is very important, I feel, which we need to really focus upon. You know, that is one thing which we need to pray, that the Lord will start using us more, powerfully than before, for the benefit of the...
Very true. See, that's what I'm telling you. The more we are in union with the Lord, more all these things will come naturally, automatically.
Correct.
When there's fire, automatically there'll be heat.
Yeah.
We don't have to say, there should be heat. Lit the fire. Heat will be there as a natural byproduct.
Absolutely, Father.
So, that fire of love. So, let's see the time. Oh, it's almost time. Okay, and I'll not jump into the next one. So, tomorrow I will conclude by saying how we know it. I'm sure this you would have heard a lot, so I'm not going to go into detail about the Holy Spirit, what we should do, praying, that steps you might have, staying with Mary, reading the Word, and so on. The Word of God be rich in you, and so on. All those things I will not go into. I'm sure you might have heard it often. Tomorrow I will conclude by saying the Holy Spirit in our daily lives and in our vocation, in our call, and in different aspects of our thing, how we keep him alive in our heart, why at all there is a need to pray, why we have to ask, so on. We'll go into that tomorrow. And with that, I'll conclude about these two gifts outside. Then I'll go into seven gifts. Seven petitions. Okay, today shall we conclude then? So I'll give you blessings through the intercession of blessed.
Before you finish, I just wanted to announce what we are going to do next week, Father. We are starting a new series on the Holy Eucharist Monday.
Good.
By Brother Raghu. We are starting. It's an amazing Brother Raghu teaching this in the Logos Retreat Center. This is one of the powerful talks. This shows he explains the Catholic view, how important the power of the Holy Eucharist. So I would encourage all of you to please pass on this word, because this is a series which has to be, which is recommended that we participate it every day, because you don't have to miss it. So encourage others to participate, so that we will be able to benefit out of it. Yeah. So just
you can send it on WhatsApp, so some of us can put it on our status, so many would see it.
Yeah. I'm sending that.
So that can be put on WhatsApp. Then if you put it on status, many would see it.
Yeah.
Then you can also see how many have seen it. So that way, it's one way of evangelizing, no?
Yes. Hey,
by the way, like this, telling people and bringing people to listen to it is in evangelization.
Yes. Okay, Father, we will bow down now for the priesthood.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thank you, brothers and sisters.
Thank you, Father.
Welcome.
Thank you, Brother Jose. God bless.
Bye. Thank you. Bye.